This morning, and a blessing to have an extra hour of sleep, right? Amen, amen. Amen, amen. Amen. Yes. Well, today is a special day because it is the All Saints Sunday. And I don't know if you have ever done anything like that before, but on All Saints Sunday, I usually try to remember those that have passed on between this All Saints Sunday and the last All Saints Sunday. And I looked in the book, and I'm hoping that I've gotten them all, but there are four individuals that have been a part of our church that we need to at least remember. And I would like to also share with you that we even put a candle up there on the altar for you to be looking at that during our worship service, so that you too can remember these people and not necessarily pray for them, but to pray for the families that are left behind. Rita Guthridge passed away on the 19th of November last year. We want to remember her, Vernon. I know you remember her almost every day, don't you? And we want to remember her. But Terry McCarty, I looked for who Terry McCarty was. I don't know who that person is.
Ray Johnson's mom.
That's Ray Johnson's mother. Okay, we didn't have a date for her, but we want to remember her as well. And for Gail Nassage, who passed away January 25th this year. Again, I don't know who that is. Maybe you do. Member of our church here. And let us also remember Corbin Smith, who passed away just this last September. These were people of the congregation. These were people that were a part of the group here at St. John's. And now we believe that they're at home with Jesus and would never want to come back here and be with us here. But we're someday going to see them and go forward in faith and in love, and enjoy the fellowship through all eternity. But I do want to remember Rita and Terry and Gail and Corbin on this special All Saints Sunday. Let's pray together. Our gracious God in heaven, we come before you today, and we know that while we are here on this earth, we are busy doing the things that you called us to do. And then, Father, when that time comes, you call us home to be with you. And even though those of us that are here feel sad that we are left behind, we know that these that have come home to be with you are rejoicing in your presence today and rejoicing in the glory that can come from knowing you as Lord and Savior. We thank you for Rita, and we pray for Vernon, the rest of the family. We pray, God, for the Johnsons and the loss of their mom, Terry. We pray for the Johnsons and ask, God, that you might minister to them, encourage them. And for the family of Gail, we'd ask, oh God, that you would again comfort and strengthen, as well as for Nancy and the family in the loss of Corbin. But Lord, we may look at these as loss, and you look at them as gain, and so do these people. And so, Father, we want to, just for a moment here, remember these that have gone from us today, or this last year. Bless us, O God, with remembrance, and may these memories be good and blessed even now. So thank you, Father, for these four people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. We welcome you to this gathering of the saints, both here and in the heavenly kingdom, and let us worship God together. God, you went ahead of Elijah to Zarephath to provide for him and the widow's family. Remind me that wherever I go this week, you're already there preparing the way. Remember that as you enter into worship here today. We also have another special day, and that is that this Thursday, we have Veterans Day. Now, I'm going to ask, how many of you are veterans in the church here this morning? Okay, we got a veteran here, there, all right? Very good. Well, thank you, veterans, for your service and for the work that you have done. Veterans Day, as you can read a little bit of a history there, started a long, long time ago, and it carries on even today. I understand there was down in Canal Winchester yesterday a big parade and some all-you-can-eat pancakes type thing that was going on in Canal. I think there's probably going to be another parade in Columbus for the veterans. But veterans, the ones that we have here, receive from us thanks to you for the work that you did as you served. I know, Ted, you took some shrapnel and everything, didn't you?
It was an onboard ship accident.
Onboard ship accident, yeah. Well, we thank you, veterans, that you're willing to do that. I tried to be a veteran. They didn't want me. They made me 4F, believe it or not. Because I had asthma so bad that they said, no, we can't take you. And so then I'm wondering, what in the world am I going to do? And guess what? God says, I'll call you into my service. And I came into the ministry shortly after that. But we do thank the veterans that are here today. Also, we're getting close to another special holiday. Which is that? Christmas! Yes, Christmas! That's what I was thinking of the one before Christmas. Thanksgiving, absolutely. And you know, I thought, I'm just going to throw this in here, just going to give you an idea of a new Thanksgiving tradition. And that is, and I put this in early so that you'll have plenty of time to do this, if you decide, and I think you should decide, just to think back on some people that you really thank for being in your life, all right? Not just your husband, not just your wife, but somebody that you really thank for being in your life. And maybe you can just jot them a little card, just a little note to say, at this Thanksgiving time, not only do I want to give thanks to God, but I want to to give thanks to you for our friendship or our relationship or whatever, all right? There's a little bit of an example down there at the bottom, but express genuine thanksgiving to God and another person, and you can just do it through a quick little letter. Snail mail, but it's a good thing to do, all right? Do you, any of you have people in your life that you're grateful for? I hope you do. I thought we'd start a new Thanksgiving tradition. All right. The announcements are there in the bulletin. You see that. A little bit of choir practice if you want to get together.
If they're willing.
If they're willing, right after worship service. We do have communion today. And we pray that your heart is prepared for that communion time. We also have a couple of birthdays coming up this week, or one has already come up, and that's Dolores Whittington on the 6th, and also Nicola Becker. She's not with us today, huh? Say happy birthday to her, all right, from us. And then also, we've got some anniversaries. Pam, you've got your anniversary coming up this month. Congrats. Chuck and Doris Whittington, and Don and Bobby. Kellett, your anniversary is coming up. Tell me how many years it is for you.
40.
40? That's
many
wonderful.
Happy?
Ah.
How many happy years?
No.
What is this? What is this? All right. Well, happy anniversary to you and also to Martin and Jane Marty on the 21st. We'll sing a happy anniversary to them as well. And the special dates are there and also the prayer needs. Chuck is there in the back. Chuck's going to have some surgery on his shoulder coming up on the 16th. Let's remember him in prayer. I also wanted to share with you that Mary Lou Davis, we've got her in here for prayer, but actually she passed away this last week. And I think it was on Friday. She passed away. Help me out. You don't remember. But she passed away. The funeral will be... I believe it will be on Wednesday at the funeral home. I can't remember the name of the funeral home right now. Two names.
Rucker Fisher,
I think it is.
Chris Hoskinson.
Yeah. Anyway, Rucker Krishner or whatever. That will be on Wednesday, visitation on Tuesday. You'll have to look in the paper for that, for the rest of it. Pastor George Winston will be conducting that funeral, and so the family asked for him, I understand, and so he'll be taking care of the funeral, which will be at the funeral home. And we continue to lift up George and Carol Powers. They're getting over their COVID-19, and we praise God for that, and we continue to lift up Pam's brother. How's he doing lately, Pam? He's finished with chemo. All right. Feeling better. All right. We keep on praying for you. And the rest of this call committee, Sunday school, and so on is all there. Are there any special requests, any special people that we need to be praying for today? All right. Well, we are grateful that we can... Yes?
My newest niece was born about a month or so early, and has had to go in and out of Children's a couple times. Was re-released yesterday and is back at home. But it seems like every week or so something pops up.
She was born a month early. Any complications?
It was because of complications to my sister's pregnancy, I suppose. But nothing as far as being hospitalized beyond a couple days being monitored.
Well,
but she had a pretty high fever for a couple days this past week, and that's why they had to admit her again. But like I said, they were re-released yesterday, so we're hoping that that's the end of it. But
sure.
Seems every couple of days there's a new scare or something.
There is that. I know we had three preemies, and there was all those things that go on. Help me out with the name, Matt.
Lorelei.
And
the last name is Beck.
All right, we'll remember Lorelei this morning. Let's go to prayer then as we begin our worship service today. Our Heavenly Father, we again come before you and thank you for this beautiful day that you've blessed us with. It is a day of your grace and of your mercy, and Lord, we know that that grace is new to us every morning, and we are so grateful for that. Lord, we would not be able to carry on and do the things that we're doing and accomplish anything without your grace and your mercy, your spirit and your love constantly being poured out upon us. We pray for this church, oh God, as we reach out to this community, as we gather together, oh God, to minister to one another. Lord Jesus, I do pray that you would bless us with your spirit, that we might know that your spirit is working within us and leading us and directing us and guiding us and showing us the truth of your word. Thank you, God, for the promise of the second coming of Christ, and that this earth is not all there is, that we can come home to be with you. We thank God of these different people in our church that have need of prayer right now. We pray for Chuck as he goes into surgery, that the doctors would have great wisdom, skill, and knowledge to go ahead and do the work that needs to be done. We do pray for Becky Becker. I know that she's struggling right now with the loss of her daughter, Mary Lou. I do pray for her that you would comfort her and help her through this time that she has to go through. We continue to thank you, Lord, for George and Carol Powers. May you continue to show them strength and healing from this horrible COVID disease. We ask, oh God, that you would continue to show your grace to Pam's brother. Lord God, I pray that you would, through this whole situation, draw him close to you, and that he would turn to you in trust and in faith. Lord, we lift up before you the call committee, as well as our Sunday school children, the adult growth group, and all the different things that are going on within this church. Lord Jesus, we pray that you might help us to know more and more about you, and then so to speak and so to act more like your Son, Jesus Christ. We continue to pray, O God, for this service. May all things that we do here today bring honor and glory to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, let's begin with doing some singing today. It is there on the screen. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. If you want to follow along the notes, you can look in that green book that you've got in the pew, and then we can do some singing. Let's stand as we do. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. Discussing different things and in our own time of personal devotions, and I remember one of the things that we talked about was peace. One of the things that you know that you have if you have Jesus is peace. The peace of God which passes all understanding. And you know what? That peace should make you very glad. It really should. It should make you rejoicing. Last week we sang a song. Bye-bye. Get all excited. Go tell everybody that Jesus Christ just came. We sang that last week. You didn't know it, did you? No, you didn't. You do know this one, though. Go back and let's do this one all over again. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. Here we go. I will enter his courts with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say this. Make me even if you're sad today, all right? Even if you're sad, God is able to do a lot with us and to help us even to get over some of that sadness. This is a song that I enjoy singing. He is able, more than able, to accomplish what concerns me today. Let's make this our testimony before the Lord today. Here we go. He is able, more than able, to accomplish what concerns me today. You may be seated. We're going to call upon Ted, and he's going to share with us the scripture today.
Which standeth for the children of thy people, and there shall be a time of trouble such as never was, since there was a nation even to the same time, and at that time thy people shall be delivered, everyone that shall be found written in the book. And many of them that sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, and some to shame and everlasting contempt. And they that be wise shall shine as the brightness of the firmament, and they that turn many to righteousness as the stars forever and ever.
Our gospel lesson is recorded also for us in Mark in chapter 13 today. Mark in chapter 13. And I would love to read the whole chapter to you, but we're not going to take the time to do that. Just the first 13 verses today, because the whole chapter deals with what we're talking about today, and that is the hope of the coming of our Lord and Savior. So let's stand as we take a look at Mark in chapter 13. Let's stand in reverence for the gospel. And as Jesus came out of the temple, one of his disciples said to him, "Look, teacher, what wonderful stones and what wonderful buildings." I was looking at the temple and how beautiful the temple was. And Jesus said to him, "Do you see these great buildings? There will not be left here one stone upon another that will not be thrown down." And as he sat on the Mount of Olives opposite the temple, Peter and James and John and Andrew asked him privately, "Tell us, when will these things be, and what will be the sign when all these things are about to be accomplished?" And Jesus began to say to them, "See that no one leads you astray. Many will come in my name, saying, 'I am he,' and they will lead many astray. And when you hear of wars and rumors of wars, do not be alarmed. This must take place, but the end is not yet. For For nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be earthquakes in various places. There will be famines. These are but the beginning of the birth pains. But be on your guard, for they will deliver you over to councils, and you will be beaten in synagogues, and you will stand before governors and kings for my sake, to bear witness before them. And the gospel must first be proclaimed to all nations, and when they bring you to trial and deliver you over, do not be anxious beforehand what you are to say, but say whatever is given you in that hour, for it is not you who speak, but the Holy Spirit. And brother will deliver brother over to death, and the father his child. And children will rise against parents and have them put to death. And you will be hated by all for my name's sake. But the one who endures to the end will be saved. Here ends the reading of our scripture this morning. You may be seated. We're going to call upon our ushers right now, and they're going to wait upon you for the morning offering. Ushers, please come. Before you with thanksgiving in our hearts, and we are so grateful for the gifts that you give to this church through your people of this church. May your blessing now rest upon these that have given, as well as this gift, for we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, normally, I don't usually do a children's sermon on Communion Sunday. But because I didn't get to give one last week, I want to give one this week. How's that sound? So kids, come on up. Come on up. Yes. Here they come. Hiya. Good to have you here with us today. Well, like I said, I don't usually do this on Communion Sunday, but I thought I'd do it today. Oh, simply because I think it's kind of fun to talk about these things. And we're on the letter G. We're trying to go through the alphabets. Remember that? It goes A, B, C, D, E, F, G. That's right. I want to talk to you about a guy by the name of Gehazi today. His name starts with a G. Gehazi. And you know what he did for a living? This is what he did. He served the prophet Elisha. Now, there was this guy by the name of Elisha that lived many, many years ago, and he just did whatever God told him to do, and he always did good things, and he was a really good guy. But this guy served, Gehazi served Elisha. Well, one day there was a commander that came way up from, down from way up north in Syria because he wanted to be healed of his leprosy. Now, leprosy is a terrible disease. It's worse than COVID even. It's really bad. And so he thought for sure that Elisha would come out and he would do some mumbo jumbo and dance and so on and heal this man by the name of Naaman. Well, he didn't. You know what he told him to do? he said, listen, I want you to go down to the river and wash in the river. Well, Naaman wasn't really happy about that. But he did say that he would do that. He finally went down and he did it. Okay? And he came back and all of his leprosy was gone. Gone. It was completely taken away from him. And so then he said to Elisha, Elisha, I want to give you these clothes. I want to give you these this big bag of silver coins and gold coins. And I want to thank you for healing me. I want to thank you for doing this for me. And you know what Elisha said? I don't want any of it. No, you keep all your stuff. Well, Gehazi looked at that and thought, That's a lot of money. That's a lot of money that he's saying no to. Well, Naaman took off, but then Gehazi got this idea. I think I'll run after this guy, and I'll get some of that money. And so he went, and then he lied to the man and said, oh, we've got some people that just showed up that really need the money, so can you give us the money and the clothes? And sure enough, Gehazi took them. And then he took them back to his tent. And he put them underneath his tent. And then he went to talk to Elisha. And Elisha said to him, what did you do, Gehazi? Nothing. I do nothing. And Elisha said, you went and you got some money from Naaman, didn't you? Naaman. And he said, yeah, I guess I did. I said that we weren't going to do that. And Gehazi said, yeah, but I thought if we could use it, if we... No, Gehazi, no. And so he said the leprosy that was on Naaman will now fall on you, Gehazi. And Gehazi got all full of leprosy. And you know why he got all full of leprosy? Because he lied. He lied. Tell me, is it a good thing to lie?
No.
Why? You get in two times more trouble. That's probably true. It's not a good thing to lie. And you know, I can't help but think that sometimes we're tempted to lie and not to tell the truth. And you know, this story of Gehazi should always tell us, oh boy, it's not good to lie. I better be truthful. When mom asks you about something that you did, you better say to yourself, I remember Gehazi. I better tell the truth and not lie. Lying is not what God wants us to do. God wants us to always be honest and true. Okay? Remember that? Let's pray. Father, thank you for stories like Gehazi. We thank you, God, for these young children. And I pray, Lord, that you would help them to remember Gehazi and lying. It's never good. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. There's some treats there for you, kids. And the rest of us are going to turn in I think it's in the green hymn book. It's called Shine, Jesus, Shine. Shining, Jesus, light of the world, shine up. Shine. Not one that we sing very often, but it is a good testimony of what we really desire. Shine, Jesus, shine. Well, in Mark in chapter 13, we've read a number of verses this morning. I want to also take a look at starting with verse 33, verse 32, as a matter of fact, where it says, "But concerning this day or that hour, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. And be on guard, keep awake, for you do not know when the time will come. It's like a man going on a journey when he leaves home and puts his servants in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to stay awake, and therefore stay awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening or at midnight or when the rooster crows or in the morning, lest he come suddenly and find you asleep. And what I say to you, I say to all, stay awake." Heavenly Father, these are your words. We pray that you would bless them and encourage the rest of us as we gather to hear that word. Fill us with your Spirit, for we need that Spirit in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I do want to talk to you today about some second coming things. We're not going to get into the whole thing of the second coming, but there are some things that I do want to share with you. And I always get amazed at the wave of enthusiasm that is generated the moment we start speaking about second coming things, end time prophecies. I remember in the last parish that I was at, we usually would pull out, 10 or 12, I suppose, for Bible study. And then I said, "We're going to go through the book of Revelation." And all of a sudden, 50 people showed up. And that was a rather small church, but 50 people showed up. And you know, the moment that we start talking about the end time things, that usually happens. People want to know what's going on and what the Lord has got in mind concerning the second coming. I remember one such prophet was an Adventist leader by the name of William Miller. He lived back in the late 1700s and 1800s. And he had a movement that both the Jehovah's Witness as well as the Seventh-day Adventists, they found their roots out of Miller. And Miller first predicted that Christ would return on the 21st of March in 1842. Well, I'll tell you, everybody was going to get ready for it, but then he started thinking a little bit further about it, revised the date to April 3rd of 1843. All right? 3,500 people showed up. They jammed the Boston Advent Temple, only to be greatly disappointed. Very disappointed. Now, you would think that maybe that movement would have died because of things like that. It didn't. Rather, it continued to grow because Miller decided to recalculate the date, and now he's shooting for April 18th, 1844. Well, the Messiah didn't show up then either. Then, a lot of frustration of the followers and so on, and a number of people started leaving. Well, undeterred by these horrible failures, Miller came up with another date, the 22nd of October in 1844. He published this, he got it all set, he was spreading it throughout the country, and surprisingly, that third date really rallied his followers, and they began to spread the news about this second coming with such enthusiasm that they gathered and gathered and gathered, and again, were disappointed. William Miller himself, on another time, began to peddle Ascension Rose, the modern day equivalent of a nice long t-shirt, saying that Jesus was coming back. You know? Well, we've had a number of different things like that. You say, well, that was way back there in the 1800s. Well, how about if we get a little closer? All right, just a little closer. How many of you remember a guy by the name of Harold Camping? Yeah, remember that name? He prophesied, predicted that the Lord would come back on May 21st, 2011. That's just 10 years ago. He said they were going to come back, and he was going to come back at that time. Well, he had to revise his prediction because it failed, and his second prediction was for October 21, 2011. Again, not true. But his prediction was very plain, and this is what Harold Camping said. Christians would ascend to heaven while sinners would be left behind to suffer 5 months' worth of natural disasters before the earth ignited into a fireball. Any of you fall for that Maya calendar program? Yeah. The Maya calendar kind of predicted that something catastrophic was going to happen on December 21st in 2012. Well, if the guys would have paid attention to what Jesus said here in our text, they never would have come up with such foolish notions and foolish thoughts. I think this was mainly just to try to get people to follow them. It was a power grab, you might say. But if they would have followed what the scripture makes it very plain here as saying, no one is going to know the times or the dates. Matter of fact, none of the angels in heaven, not even the Son, but only the Father knows that date when he says to his Son, go get my children. We don't know what that date is. Jesus is telling us that we don't know that date, but we do know that we are to be on guard. Verse 33 of our text, be alert, you do not know when the time will come. In Mark 13, verse 33. You know, when I look at the lectionary for today and I look at what we've got coming up in the very near future, two of the three best holidays of the year, we've got Thanksgiving coming up, we've got Christmas coming up. And both of those should be a reminder to us continually that our focus has got to get back on God. Our focus has got to get back on what Jesus Christ has done for us. It is a time for us, and we should really look at it this way. When we get together at Thanksgiving and also at Christmas, just like Jesus came at the first coming, he promised to come back at the second time. We need to look forward with hope to that second coming of Christ. And see, that's what this lectionary is really all about here today. The text here is all about looking forward to that time that you and I shall be with Jesus forever. I happen to think we should all live in that hope of his second coming. You know, in John chapter 14 and verse 2, it says, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. But I go to prepare a place for you, that where I am, there you will be also. You know, this is the very first time that Jesus really refers to the second coming of Christ. The very first time in John chapter 14. And we find here that he is saying, listen, I am coming back, and where I'm going to be, you can be there forever. The first mention of the second coming. Now, I think this caught the disciples by a big surprise because he just told them, I'm going away. They didn't want him to go away. They wanted him to stick around and set up the kingdom. But he assured them, I will return. I am coming back for the second time. And since the Lord rose from the dead, his coming for the church and for the believers to be with him for all eternity has been something that you and I should be looking forward to with great anticipation and great hope, knowing that this is going to take place. Now, I want you to understand the Lord's hope that we're talking about here, about the Lord's return, is not just mere hope that I hope it happens, but rather the Bible calls it a blessed hope. By blessed hope, he simply means it is a special hope that should energize every single one of us as believers. energize us to know that this world is not all that there is. We have a hope, and that is we have a final home in glory forever and ever. That's the hope that we need to focus in on. Even Titus chapter 2 and verse 13 says this, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior Jesus Christ. Someday it's going to happen. And guess what? This is what's going to take place. The Bible says that the Lord shall come down from the heavens, and there shall be a shout, the voice of an archangel, the trump of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. So I want you to pay attention here. That if you happen to be out and about traveling, and all of a sudden you see all the graves starting to pop open and people flowing out of them, that you need to say, ho, here comes Jesus. Here comes Jesus. And that is our hope. And that's what we're looking forward to do. Well, I know that that is something that we should all be looking forward to. That is something that we should get excited about. But we also need to know that while we're here on this earth, God still has work for us to do. God still has work for us to do. The second thought behind this whole theme of chapter 13 in the book of Mark is that God still has work for us to do here on earth. Now, we're called to live the Christian life in our communities. We are to be loving our neighbors as ourselves. We are to be sharing the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Those are the things that he tells us he wants us to do. You know, I ran across something the other day on my, as I was just reading, and it is something that I think should be plastered as a theme for every single one of our churches. And it's this, it's a quote from Spurgeon. He says, it's the whole business of the whole church to preach the whole gospel to the whole world. Stop and think about that a minute. It's the whole business of the whole church to preach the whole gospel to the whole world. God has said that he wants us to be busy leading people to know Christ Jesus as Lord. God has put mankind in charge of this world until the time that he comes back. He expects the church to fulfill his mission. What is the mission? What mission do we have as St. John's Lutheran Church in Newark, Ohio? You know, those are the things that we need to stop and think about. The church's work, the church's mission, the church's idea of why it is even a church in Newark, Ohio. I want you to recall that God has given the Great Commission to each and every one of us. That all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me, Jesus said. Therefore, go make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I've commanded you. And lo, I'll be with you all the time. I think Jesus wants us to look forward to the second coming. But he also wants us to realize that we have a focus in living here on this earth. And it is not the focus of how much can I get to get ahead of everybody else? How much can I have? How much life can I enjoy? Rather, what is it that Jesus wants me to do? How am I going to get involved with what he has in mind for my life? Because, you know, it's very important for us to recognize that all of eternity, the things that we have done here on this earth, the things that we have done for God, will count in all of eternity. He wanted us to be secure in the knowledge that he will come back. But you know what? He doesn't want us to just be stargazers either. I don't know, you you've probably read enough about Martin Luther, but I ran across this and I thought it was interesting that Martin Luther is reputed to have said that even if he knew Christ was going to return tomorrow, he would still plant an apple tree today. You know, when we stop and think about it, yeah, we're looking forward to that time that Jesus is coming back. But we're also looking forward to the time that we can win souls for Christ while we're here. Encourage other Christians while we're here. Help those that have need while we're here. Be busy about the work that God has told us to do. But there's another thing. The final thing that I want to bring out in this text is very plain. It's in verse 33, 34, 35, 37, and so on. The final emphasis for our gospel reading today is that Jesus wants us to be on our guard. I find it interesting that our Lord in his discourse tells us four different times in these verses to keep on the alert. I looked it up in the Greek. And to keep on the alert, or to stay alert, or be on the alert, the word there is just one word. It's called gregario. Gregario. And it means to keep yourself awake, to make an effort to learn of what might be a potential future threat, to be alert, or to be on the lookout for, and to be vigilant. Why? The Bible says that I'm going to hold you in the palm of my hand. No one is going to separate you from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. We know that those are promises that God gives to us, but we need to find out what is a threat to our faith. Or how easily can I be drawn away from the truth of the gospel? Which happens today. He wants us to be so well schooled in the scriptures that we're not going to be taken by false prophets. There were a lot of people that followed the Miller, this guy by the name of Miller. There's a lot of people that followed Camping. They thought, oh, he's really got the answers. No, he was a false prophet. And we're running a whole slew of false prophets today that are really pulling you away from the things of God. What is a false prophet? A false prophet is a person who disguises himself as a servant of righteousness, a preacher of the gospel, and it's to alter your thinking. I'm going to make a bold statement here, because I happen to believe that 90%, all right, 90% of the preachers that are on TV today are leading you down the wrong path. Oh, really? Preacher, are you sure? Yeah, I'm pretty sure. Preachers like Benny Hinn and Mike Murdoch and Franklin Jensen and Creflo Dollar and T.D. Jakes and Joel Osteen. Did you know Joel Osteen got up a number of years ago now, got up and preached to the church, his wife preached to the church, that Jesus was just a man until God placed his Holy Spirit upon him, and then he became the Son of God. You didn't think that was so bad? Here's what she's really saying. The inference is that when you have the Holy Spirit, you are God. False. Wrong. But now also, I need to be careful that we don't just criticize them and become negative on them. Because I listened to Rod Parsley over here a little while ago. And outside of the crazy stuff that he was preaching, he got down to the end of his program, and you know what he did? He preached the gospel. He preached the gospel. But too many times can I hear the gospel that is coming out of the mouths of these preachers with false motives. False motives. They want your money. please, just send in a cloth. I'll pray over your cloth. Hey, better put some money in with that cloth. You know? Send in your money and I'll help your kids be saved. Send me your money and I'll take care of every problem you got in your life. Send in your money and I'll make you rich. Send in your money. These are all false. And we need to be very careful, especially here at the end of the time, just before Jesus comes back, that we don't follow crazy people that are telling us things that are not recorded within the Bible. This is the scripture here, and it is God's word, completely holy. And it is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, and for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. It didn't say some other preacher's doctrines. It's talking about the doctrines of the scripture only. And that's what gives you the perfection before Christ that you so desire to have. Now, there are good TV preachers. I cannot tell you that they're not. I love listening to Dr. David Jeremiah, Charles Stanley, Chuck Swindoll, Michael Youssef. I can go on and on. There's a number of them. But there is no doubt in my mind that for every good one, there's 10 out there that are trying to take from you rather than to encourage your spiritual life. We need to look out. We need to be vigilant. So when we think about this portion of scripture here, this second coming of the Christ, we need to be challenged to carefully mull over what we hear from our pulpits and what we believe in our hearts over this time that we are living in here, the time of the end. We need to follow Jesus Christ and His Word alone. In conclusion, I want you to know this. Number one, one day Jesus will return. I think we are living in the advent of that time. I really do. The earthquakes, the pestilences, the problems, the nations rising up against nation, we're living in the time of the end. But Jesus also wants us to go on living as if He was coming, guess what, this afternoon. You're all going to miss the football game if Jesus comes this afternoon. We need to be on the alert. As a matter of fact, I think we need to be on the red alert. Jesus also wants us to be on guard against these false prophets. And I think we need to be DEFCON 1 when it comes to listening to these followers of Satan that are leading us away. I'm looking forward to the coming of Christ. I really am. I figure it could happen any day. We are living at that time that one day there will be a shout from heaven. The trumpet shall sound. The dead in Christ shall rise first. And then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together in the clouds to ever be with the Lord. That's the promise of His scripture. I am coming. It's better than what Arnold Schwarzenegger said. I'll be back. The angels, believe it or not, looked down at the disciples as Jesus rose up into heaven and said to them, "What are you standing here gazing up into the clouds for? This same Jesus, who you have seen go, will come again just as you have seen it go." Are you looking forward to the second coming of Christ?
Yes.
I am. I hope you are too. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this time, and we thank you, God, that we can come forward and receive from you the reminder to always keep in mind that our focus needs to be on you and on you alone. Oh, Heavenly Father, keep us today close to you until that time that you shall call us to be at home with you forever. What a joy that will be. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Before our communion today, we're going to ask you to sing one more song today, and that is "Let Us Break Bread Together on Our Knees." Let's sing together. Our Lord Jesus Christ, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." And after the same manner also, he took the cup when he had supped, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Our gracious God, we would ask in Jesus' name that you would consecrate these special gifts to your people, that they may receive from you that promise of eternal life, of forgiveness of sins, and of true salvation. And may you bless these gifts to each and every one. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We have communion today, and we encourage all of you that are of communion age to come forward and to receive of the body and the blood of the Lord. And this is to remind you of what Jesus Christ has done for you. I pray that when you're here today, that you're not only thanking God, for asking him to forgive your sins, but also thanking God for all that he has done so that you might have the grace and the mercy that he desires to give to you. You should rejoice today. When you come forward, you should rejoice that Jesus has done this for you, something you could not do for yourself. Let's pray that prayer that he's taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We're going to ask the ushers and those that would like to receive communion to please come forward at this time. Those of you that are going to hand out the elements, please stand together as we close our service and communion today. Our Father in heaven, we are so grateful for what you have done for us. We know we could not do any of this for ourselves. We know that we could never even begin to understand the forgiveness of sins. But God, we thank you for what you have done and how you have made for us a way back to the Father. Bless these people that have gathered together. May they receive the sure assurance that you love them, that you care for them, that you forgive them, and that you promise to them eternal life. Blessings, O God, are what we are looking for here on this earth. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in God's peace and
serve the Lord.